141 here.
I was once a sinner, but I came, pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine.
Toward the front, 229, please. 229. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Amen. Here. Okay.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day, day I will never forget. After I've wandered in darkness away, Jesus my Savior I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend, he met the need of my heart. Shadow dispelling with joy and telling, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine, justified fully through Calvary's love. Oh, what a standing is mine. so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came. Took the offer of sin and improperty, saved me, oh, praise his dear name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Now I'm a hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day, when at the cross I believe. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from his precious hand I receive. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down.
Missionary every day.
tell the world that Jesus is the way. The Lord is soon returning, there is no time to lose. So be a missionary, God's own emissary. Be a missionary today. Let's go!
Oh, you're doing good with that. So should we try it without the sign?
Yeah.
Try it without it. Let's try it without. All right, you ready?
Be a missionary every day. Tell the world that Jesus is the way. Be it in the town or country or a busy avenue. Hey, Africa or Asia, the task is up to you. So be a missionary every day. Tell the world that Jesus is the way. The Lord is soon returning. We have no time to lose. So be a missionary, God's own emissary. Be a missionary today. Let's go!
If you'd rise with me and to honor God's word, and we'll be reading from Genesis chapter 32, verses 9 through 23. Genesis 32, verses 9 through 23. God's word says, "And Jacob said, O God of my father Abraham, and God of my father Isaac, the Lord which saidst unto me, return unto thy country and to thy kindred, and I will deal well with thee. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies, and of all the truth which thou hast showed unto thy servant. For with my staff I passed over this Jordan, and now I am become two bands. Deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau. For I fear him, lest he will come and smite me, and the mother with the children. And thou saidst, I will surely do thee good, and make thy seed as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. And he lodged there that same night, and took of that which came to his hand a present for Esau his brother. 200 she-goats, and 20 he-goats, 200 ewes, and 20 rams, 30 milk camels, with their colts, 40 kine, and 10 bulls, 20 she-asses, and 10 foals. And he delivered them into the hand of his servants. Every drove by themselves, and said unto his servants, Pass over before me, and put a space betwixt drove and drove. And he commanded the foremost, saying, When Esau my brother meeteth thee, and asketh thee, saying, Who art thou? And whither goest thou? And whose are these before thee? Then thou shalt say, They be thy servant Jacob's. It is a present sent unto my lord Esau, and behold, also he is behind us. And so commanded he the second and the third, and all that followed the drove, saying, On this manner shall ye speak unto Esau when ye find him. And say ye moreover, Behold, thy servant Jacob is behind us. For he said, I will appease him with a present that goeth before me, and afterward I will see his face, peradventure he will accept of me. So went the present over before him, and himself lodged that night in the company. And he rose up that night, and took his two wives, and his two woman servants, and his 11 sons, and passed over the ford Jabbok. And he took them, and sent them over the brook, and sent over that he had. Amen. Amen. Father, we gather before you this day to ask your blessing, Lord, upon this service and upon the preaching of thy word this morning, Lord. We're here to be fed, Lord, of thy word and to learn more about you this day so that we may draw near to you, Lord, and be used more effectively for the purpose that you've created us, Lord. And I pray your anointing upon the pastor this morning as he's set to deliver thy word to us. And please fill him, Lord, with thy Holy Ghost, that we may discover more of your bountiful treasures, Lord, from thy word, and that it may help us to go forth and live the life that you've set before us, Lord. So please, as this year begins, Lord, lead us in the paths of righteousness for thy name's sake. You've planned them out, Lord, for us, and just guide us and help us to walk with them. If we get off the path, Lord, put us back on it quickly, and bring us to repentance so that we may be cleansed and purified for thy service, Lord. And we praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
You may be seated.
Thank you, Brother John. Appreciate that. couple of weeks ago, my wife and I crossed the Rainbow Bridge. It's called the Rainbow Bridge because you can see Niagara Falls, both Canadian and American side. And so many, many times when the sun is out, because of the mist rising from those waterfalls, you can see the rainbows, and they're very prominent. So the bridge from the United States over to Canada is called the Rainbow Bridge. And I'm telling you, once we crossed that, we were in a foreign country. I mean, the money's different. The speed limits are different. They're written all different. You know, a lot of things seem similar, but still, it is a different place. Quite interesting how they do things, how they build things, and the numbers of their roads are different, and all that kind of thing. How we were there. So, crossing over can be an exciting time, interesting time. It'd been 20 years since we'd gone to Michigan. My wife had gone before, but for me, 20 years. So things had changed. Some things were the same, but a lot of things had changed. And, you know, as we drove along, we kept saying, boy, look at this. This is different. I don't remember that being there. What happened to that place? How come that's not there any longer? And all of those kinds of things. And, you know, some crossing overs, you know, have a remembrance for a lifetime. We've just crossed over from 2013 into 2014. Who knows what this year's going to bring? Amen? Who really knows? Now, my father, when he was in World War II in the Navy, was stationed out into the Pacific, and he crossed over the international date line. And when he did that, he got a special card. Now, as boys, my brother and I were able to look at and handle a lot of the memorabilia that he had from World War II and from being in the Philippines and all that kind of thing. We could handle a lot of the stuff that he had. But that card that he got when he crossed over that international date line, he would not let us touch that. Because if he ever had to cross that line again, he wanted to make sure he had that card with him, because there's a whole initiation that goes with that. On board ship, they take and they make these people that have never crossed that line, they make them do all kinds of terrible things. And one of the things they make them do is they run down through all these men who have boards. And they hit them as hard as they can as they're going down through the line. And then after that, they've got to go up and they've got to kiss the Buddha belly. It's what it's called. And they take the fattest man they can find on the ship, and they put axle grease all over his belly. And everybody's got to come up and kiss his belly. And when they kiss his belly, they take his head and they rub it right in that axle grease. And their face is all covered in axle grease. And that's the initiation. So for my father, that crossing over, he always remembered that. He didn't want to go through that again. He really did not. And that card that he had, if he showed that card, he didn't have to go through that initiation again. Some things change when we cross over, and what a difference that it makes. You know, some people have crossed over the ocean. We have them sitting in the room with us. What a difference that's made in their life. It'll change them forever. It really will. You know, some people have changed from church to a church, and that makes a difference. Some people have changed in lots of different ways in this year. So we're starting here. This is the first Sunday, 2014. Yes, I will get back to our study in the book of Luke. We will get back there, but not this Sunday. We're here looking at some crossing overs. Where Brother John read this morning at verse 22, did you notice there? It said, "And he rose up that night and took his two wives and his two women servants and his 11 sons and passed over the ford Jabbok." The ford is a branch of the river that goes there, that makes up the Jordan River. And he crossed over. You know? So, crossing over for us into this new year. Some things are familiar to us. I mean, really, did it seem any different, you know, when you got up January 1st than it did when you got up December 31st? Didn't seem any different. But we don't know. We can anticipate and we can look at things. We have no ideas what 2014 is going to do for us. We don't know. Maybe 2014 is going to have, you know, some marriages, maybe some births in it, maybe some conversions, and unfortunately, maybe some deaths. Mm-hmm. And we just don't know what 2014.
That's right.
We have a whole new year in front of us. Maybe 2014 will be the year Jesus Christ comes back.
Amen.
Takes out those dead in him. And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds, ever be with the Lord in the air. We don't know. The Bible shows some crossing overs that'll teach us how to grow more in Jesus Christ. And this first one that we have here, we'll start with this first crossing over. It's that fear found forgiveness. Here in Genesis chapter 32, we have fear found forgiveness. Verse 7, you notice that it said this, "Then Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed, and he divided the people that was with him, and the flocks and herds and the camels into two bands." And you saw there also at verse 11, "Deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he will come and smite me and the mother with the children." And to smite someone isn't just to smack them one. I mean, it's to kill them. Yeah, and that's something to be fearful about. Am I right? You know, he was fearful. Take a look with me here in chapter 33, in verse 1 through 4, if you would. "And Jacob lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, Esau came, and with him 400 men." Now, we're not told how many servants he had, Jacob had. We're not told how many, but he had enough to, you know, go with some of those droves, you know, that Brother John read about there, you know, and all those different droves with the she-goats and the milk camels and the kine and all that stuff. He had some, but he didn't have 400 men. That's a sizable army, amen? "And he divided the children unto Leah and unto Rachel and unto the two handmaids, and he put the handmaids and their children foremost," chapter 33, verse 2 says, "and Leah and her children after, and Rachel and Joseph hindermost. And he passed over before them and bowed himself to the ground 7 times until he came near to his brother. And Esau ran to meet him and embraced him and fell on his neck and kissed him, and they wept." You see, fear found forgiveness.
Wow.
Jacob had been very, very bad to Esau, dear ones. That's why he fled to Laban, and you know, Laban his uncle. That's why he went there. He stole Esau's birthright.
Mm-hmm.
In that kind of a culture, the birthright was that the oldest was the one that was going to be the family leader and all that. And remember, Esau had been out hunting and he came in and he was hungry. And Jacob had stayed back and made that pottage of lentils. He said, "Give me something to eat. I'm hungry." He said, "Well, you got to give me something. I'm not just going to give it to you. You got to sell me. You know, we got to sell something here." He said, "Well, sell me your birthright so that if something happens to Dad, then I become number one, not you, Esau." Whew, wow, what a thing. And then, of course, later on, what he did is he knew his father was going to die, and so with the help of his mother, he plotted and he made himself to be hairy-armed like his brother Esau and put some fur around his neck and all, and his blind dad reached out to feel for his son and felt the fur and thought it was his hairy arm, his hairy neck, and blessed him and didn't have much blessing left over for Esau. So he not only stole his birthright but took his blessing from his father. Wow. It's just incredible. Take a look at Genesis chapter 27, if you would, please, and verse 41. Genesis chapter 27, verse 41. It says there, "And Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing wherewith his father blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, 'The days of mourning for my father are at hand. Then will I slay my brother Jacob.'" As soon as the mourning is over, his father dies and the mourning time is over, he's going to kill Jacob. I mean, that's how angry he was. By the way, any one of us can get that angry. And so, you know, this is what bad things he did. When Jacob fled, he had little faith and little prayer. Look there in chapter 28, if you would. You should be right close by at verse 16 through 21. After Jacob had seen this ladder in the dream and, you know, the angels going up and down the ladder, and we know that Jesus said that that ladder was himself. When he talked about it in the New Testament, in the Gospel account, that he was the ladder. But in Jacob, verse 16 of chapter 28, "awaked out of his sleep and said, 'Surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not.' And he was afraid and said, 'How dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven.' And Jacob rose up early in the morning and took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set it up for a pillar and poured oil on the top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel," which El is always God. Beth is house, the house of God, just like he said up in verse 17. "But the name of that city was called Luz at the first. And Jacob vowed a vow, saying, 'If God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God.'" And that's all the faith that he had, and that's all the prayer that he had. He didn't have too much. But now you come to chapter 32, verse 9 through 12, where John read for us. Listen to this prayer, how different. Chapter 32, verse 9, "And Jacob said, 'O God of my father Abraham, the God of my father Isaac,'" he's talking about all the promises God had given out, "'and the Lord which saidest unto me, return unto thy country and to thy kindred, and I will deal with thee.'" What faith he's got. He's hanging on to that. And then he says at verse 10, "I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and all the truth which thou hast showed unto thy servant, for with my staff I passed over this Jordan, and now I am become two bands." You know, that's humility there, amen, in verse 10. Not worthy, you know. I'm not worthy. So then verse 11, "Deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he will come and smite me and the mother with my children. And thou hast saidest," God bless you, "I will surely do thee good and make thy seed as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude." What a difference in his life. What a difference this crossing over has made. He's gone from fear to forgiveness. He's done some incredible things here. Now imagine that you're saying to me there in your minds, "Well, Pastor, you know, you keep reading all around, but you never read from verse 24 to verse 32. In this passage of Scripture here, you know, this is where Jacob wrestles with the angel of the Lord. He wrestles with Jesus Christ before he had the incarnate body that he gets, you know, through Mary's womb. He wrestles with him. Yeah, that's true. He wrestles after he's crossed over. After verse 22, he passed over the ford Jabbok. He crossed over. This crossing over found forgiveness. God says to him there at verse 28, if you will, "Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince thou hast power with God and with men, and hast prevailed." Now this is an incredible thing, because Jacob's name before meant a supplanter or a trickster, we'd say in our day today. someone who's always working it, finagling, doing these things, making the deals happen, working it out so that he gets all the benefit. But God said, that's not your name anymore. You've crossed over. Your name now is Israel. That E-L at the end again, meaning God, always that idea of God. We talk about God's name being, you know, Elohim in the Hebrew and that kind of thing, that E-L part. And he's the prince with God. And not only has power with God, but with men. An incredible kind of thing. So when Jacob crossed over, his fear was turned to faith and he found forgiveness. He found forgiveness with God, went from Jacob to Israel, and he found forgiveness with Esau. Now I know they were not the closest of brothers after that, but Esau did not kill Jacob.
Amen.
Right. Yeah. They weren't necessarily close. Well, they got together when their father died and that kind of thing. But he didn't kill him. Found forgiveness. Hey, I don't know what this year will bring. Maybe this year you will be reconciled to somebody. Maybe 2014 will be the year that bitterness inside of you gets let go and you'll be reconciled. We don't know. It's a crossing over. But let me go to a second one. The second one I titled this, Faith Found Fulfillment. Faith Found Fulfillment. And I'd ask you to turn to Exodus chapter 14, verse 21 to 31. Faith Found Fulfillment. Exodus chapter 14, verse 21 through 31. And here's what we read. All very familiar to you. Even the children in the room have heard about this. Remember this, children? Verse 21, and Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the children of Israel went unto the midst of the sea upon the dry ground, and the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. And the Egyptians pursued and went in after them to the midst of the sea, even all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. And it came to pass that in the morning watch the Lord looked unto the host of the Egyptians through the pillar of fire and of the cloud, and troubled the host of the Egyptians, and took off their chariot wheels, that they drove them heavily, so that the Egyptians said, let us flee from the face of Israel, for the Lord fighteth for them against the Egyptians. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand over the sea, that the waters may come again upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots, and upon their horsemen. And Moses stretched forth his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to his strength when the morning appeared. And the Egyptians fled against it, and the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. And the waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen and all the host of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. There remained not so much as one of them. But the children of Israel walked upon dry land in the midst of the sea. And the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And Israel saw great works which the Lord did upon the Egyptians, and the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. The Israelites thought they were going to die that day. Chapter 14, verse 10 and 11, and when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Whereof hast thou dealt thus with us, to carry us forth out of Egypt? There they were, their back was against the sea. And by the way, this is not a swamp. This is not a small amount of water. You know, they want us to think this is the Sea of Reeds. It's just kind of a swamp. Well, if it had been a swamp, they wouldn't have been afraid. They could have ran through the swamp. They could have gotten through it somehow or other. You know, many of them could have gotten away. No, this is the sea. You know, the Red Sea. It's the real thing. We're talking deep. And if it had been a swamp, how did God bring the waters back and drown the Egyptian soldiers and their horses if it was only 4 inches deep? Come on. It was a sea. A wall of water on their left hand and on their right hand, and their backs are against the sea, and the army is coming, and they figure they're going to all die. Remember that the people of Israel coming out, they were not soldiers.
Nope.
They'd all been slaves. They'd not been trained in the arts of war. And here they come with the chariots and the swords and the spears and my, oh my, oh my. They were afraid. They really were afraid. They're pressed in every way. Moses challenged their faith. Chapter 14, verse 13 and 14. And Moses said unto the people, "Fear ye not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians, whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace." Well, they saw the Egyptians. They saw them dead on the shore. That's what they saw. They were dead on the seashore. He challenged them. And folks, I want you to understand something. Faith always has legs. Faith is just not a thought. Faith does something. I do it quite often. I'll do it again today. But right here is a chair. When you folks came in, you looked at that chair, and you all said, "Yep, that's a chair. I know what that is. That's a chair." And I bet you all said in your mind, "Yeah, chairs are things people sit on." You know? And then by faith, you went ahead and you actually sat on it. Ah, and it held me up. Ah, isn't that amazing? Boy, I like these chairs. No wonder you folks like it here. This is nice. Amen. It's comfortable. But see, until I actually sat in the chair, I did not exercise my faith. I only had a thought. But I had to exercise it by sitting down. How many of you asked somebody else, "Sit in the chair first, let me see if it'll hold me up"? Did you do that when you came in? Huh? You didn't do that? Day Chief, you didn't have somebody come and sit to have Mr. Dave, please sit in the chair. No, by faith you just went ahead and sat in the chair. By faith we asked Jesus Christ to be our Savior, by faith.
Amen.
We just trust Him. It's not just a thought in our mind, we have to actually put some legs to it. Somebody said if you're going to pray for rain, you better walk around with an umbrella. Yeah? I mean, if that's what you're going to do, you'd better do that. Amen. It has to have legs. And here's what the Jewish people, they had to have legs here. And what we see in this passage of Scripture, at verse 15, chapter 14, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel, that they go forward." See, faith found fulfillment. You're going to believe God that He's going to fight for you? You know, believe Him. You're going to believe God that greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world? You know, do you believe that? We'll do something about it. Put some action to it. Put some legs to your faith, if you will. When they crossed over, they realized God can and will do what He says. Those people, they crossed over, verse 31, and Israel saw the great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians, and the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and His servant Moses. That crossing over changed those people forever, amen? Mm-hmm. Not only had they escaped bondage, but they saw their enemies defeated, and now they were headed for the promised land. And if they'd only kept a hold of that faith, they'd have gone right on into the promised land. But they doubted later on. They said, oh, the people in the promised land are like giants and we're just but grasshoppers. Forty years for that doubt. They wandered in the wilderness, and all of the ones that were adults died. How about your faith? Where's your faith? Can God do some great things? This is 2014. I mean, maybe God will give us a church building.
Amen.
He could do that this year. I'm not afraid to build a building if God wants us to do it that way. Give us some property and we'll just start in. I know what end of a hammer to grab hold of. And I know the nails that have the head on this end are for pounding in on this side. The nails that have the head on this end are for pounding in on this side. Isn't that how it works? You know, I know that kind of thing. You know, I know something about electrical wiring. You know, you just don't hold on to it while it's plugged in. Amen. I know that, yeah. You know, hey, we don't know what God will do, but faith for these people found fulfillment when they crossed over. And that's what's important. Their lack of faith made them murmur in the wilderness and made them miss going in, but they had. So this year, what will it be? Will you step out by faith and obey God? What will it be for you, 2014? Well, let me go on to the third crossing over that we're going to take a look at. And this one I titled, Fortitude Found Firmness. Fortitude Found Firmness. I'm in the book of Joshua chapter 3. A crossing over. You know, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, the next book, the sixth book in. Joshua chapter 3, verse 14 through 17. We see a crossing over here. The Word of God says this, Joshua chapter 3, verse 14. And it came to pass when the people removed from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the people. And as they that bear the ark were come unto Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for Jordan overflowed all his banks at the time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city Adam, that is beside Zaratan. And those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed and were cut off. And the people passed over right against Jericho. And the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan. And all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over Jordan. 40 years earlier, the Israelites walked through the Red Sea. This new generation was about to experience God for themselves as they walked through the Jordan River, flooded at this time. The Jordan overflowed all his banks, it says. And when that priest, that first priest carrying the ark, as soon as he stepped and put his foot to that water, the waters parted. And it stopped coming down the river. And it just piled up and piled up and piled up and piled up. And this way it just went dry, dry, dry. Incredible thing. Mm. Wow, what a thing to see here for these people. And they experienced something. Gone from Egypt, the picture of the world, and into Canaan, a picture of the promised land. What an incredible sight this must have been for them. Can you imagine stepping on shore and finding it heaven? Mm. Holding in hand and seeing that hand is God's. There's going to be a crossing over one day, folks. And this picture is our crossing over into heaven. What a time that's going to be. How wonderful that's going to be for us. But these people were determined by faith to get what God had promised. Their fortitude was this: with God's help, we can do it. With God's help, we can do it. They understood with God's help, they could cross over the Jordan. And with God's help, they could take and conquer the land that they were in. With God's help, those walls of Jericho would go down. With God's help, they'd be able to take that mountain, conquer the land. Their fortitude. They did not know what to expect as they crossed over Jordan. You know what? They found God was their rock. Isn't that something? In chapter 4, we were just reading in chapter 3. In chapter 4, look there, verse 1 through 3. And it came to pass when all the people were clean passed over Jordan, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, take you 12 men out of the people, out of every tribe a man, and command ye them, saying, take you hence out of the midst of Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones, and ye shall carry them over with you, and leave them in the lodging place where ye shall lodge this night. And they put those stones there, and that's what we call an Ebenezer. We sing about, we raise an Ebenezer. It's a pile of stones that makes us remember some things. They conquered the land as God promised and became a nation. 2014, what might you conquer this year? How will 2014 prove God to be true in his promises to you? It's a crossing over. But let me go to the fourth and final crossing over that I want to take a look at. And this one I've titled, Fugitives Found False. Fugitives Found False. Judges chapter 12, verse 4 through 6. Joshua judges the very next book. Judges chapter 12, verse 4 through 6. Fugitives Found False. And here in chapter 12, we're going to read verse 4 through 6. It says this: then Japheth gathered together all the men of Gilead and fought with Ephraim. And the men of Gilead smote Ephraim because they said, ye Gileadites are fugitives of Ephraim among the Ephraimites and among the Manassites. And the Gileadites took the passages of Jordan before the Ephraimites. And it was so that when those Ephraimites, which were escaped, said, let me go over, that the men of Gilead said unto him, art thou an Ephraimite? If he said, nay, then said they unto him, say now, Shibboleth. And he said, Sibboleth, for he could not frame to pronounce it right. Then they took him and slew him at the passages of Jordan, and there fell at that time of the Ephraimites 42,000. Japheth had won a great victory over God's enemies, the Ammonites, but it cost him greatly. You remember earlier in chapter 11, he had made a vow that if God had given him this victory, the first thing that came out of his house, he would sacrifice unto God as a burnt offering. And his daughter, his only child, came out of the house first. And he went, oh boy. The Bible says he went ahead and did what he vowed he would do. That cost him greatly, amen? But now the Ephraimites come along in chapter 12 here, and they gather themselves and they say to him, why isn't it that you included us in the battle against the Ammonites so that we would be able to be there to help you? You are so prideful, you are so wicked, Japheth, and you men of Gilead, we're going to kill you. Our army is going to kill you. You're just fugitives of Ephraim among the Ephraimites and among the Manassites. So we're just going to kill you for all of that. Can you imagine that? Their pride on their part, that they wanted to have the glory of saying that, well, we're the ones. And you know, Ephraim later on comes to the forefront. You know, the 12 tribes separate after Solomon. The next son comes along, Rehoboam, and he says, well, if you think the taxes were high before, wait till I get done with you. If you think what it was like living under my father Solomon, wait till you see what things I do. Now, I don't know that, you know, that's a king, and it's a kingly line. He'd never won an election doing that. Amen? Amen? If President Obama had told the truth, he'd never won election the first time or the second time. But he didn't tell the truth. Politicians won't do that, see? They ought to tell the truth. But, you know, so when he said that, boy, oh boy, the 10 northern tribes, they all separated from the two southern tribes of Israel. And the two northern tribes then were thought of as Ephraim. That's the center about Samaria and all that kind of thing. The Ephraimites, they were filled with pride. They wanted the limelight. They wanted the fame. They wanted to have all the glory of the battle, and they wanted to have the spoils of the battle and all that kind of thing. But what we have here in this crossing over is these Ephraimites have been defeated by Japheth. And now, you know, the battle, this all took place on the east side of Jordan. To get back to Samaria, they have to cross over the Jordan westward and go to where the Samaria is today in that area. And when they'd come to the river, they'd ask him, you an Ephraimite? And if they said no, then they'd say to them, well, say Shibboleth. Now, you know, we don't know. I mean, Shibboleth means river in Hebrew. I don't know exactly their language, dialect, and all that kind of thing, but whatever it was, they just had a hard time pronouncing that H in the word. Now, you know, these men from Nigeria, they've tried to teach me some words in Nigeria, and I have a hard time. For years, because my wife has a Chinese sister, we've tried to learn Chinese words. And, you know, that not only are the pronunciation, but when you have eight intonations for every vowel, you know, it doesn't take long to say the word wrong. Amen? And I'm thankful for most of the time the Chinese people have been gracious and let me mispronounce how to say those words. My children are from Korea, and I've tried to learn the Korean language, and boy, oh boy, oh boy, that, you know, and then I'm Italian, so I know some Italian, and I've tried to learn Spanish, and I mix up Italian and Spanish because they're related, and oh my, oh my, oh my. But you know, when my wife and I were over in Canada, if we'd asked one of them, are you Canadian or American, and one of them said, no, we're American, that would have given it away right there. But if they'd said, no, we're American, all I'd have to do is say to them, spell lazy for me. And if they went L-A-Z-Y, I'd know they were Canadian.
Right.
Because see, over in Canada, they don't say Z for that letter. They say Z. Mm-hmm. A, B, C, D, all the way up through Z. That's how they say it. X, Y, Z. Amen. That's how they say it over there. So we'd have found out pretty quick they were Canadian. Eh?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's how they answer, by the way. If you ever hear a Canadian say eh to you, say, oh, yeah, and he'll go on. It just works out that way. We learned by living so close and being in Canada so much. We learned to do that with them. They're gracious people. Thank the Lord for them. But we'd have known. And so what they did, when they made them say Shibboleth, I imagine it went something like this. Tell me what you want to cross over. Well, the river Jordan. And when they went to say river, they said it's Shibboleth, Jordan, instead of Shibboleth. And they said it wrong. They knew they were Ephraimites, and they killed them. The fugitives were found false. Isn't that something? Crossing over Jordan was not an easy thing for them. How about 2014? Are you going to be found false in some way this year? Are you going to be bragging about how spiritual you are, how much you are in tune with the Lord, and yet actually find out that you're false. This is a new year. We need to be true to God and His Word, or are we going to be found lacking? A new year is a crossing over, dear ones. What will it bring? Maybe for some, this year, 2014, will be the year of their salvation. I sure am praying that God uses all of us, that people have come to know Jesus Christ as Savior. Men and women, boys and girls, all around. That'd be a great thing. 2014. See, I look back, 1973. I mean, that's the year I crossed over from being lost to being saved, to being dead in trespasses and sins and alive in Jesus Christ, to having my home in hell, to having a home in heaven. I crossed over. Maybe this will be the year. Maybe somebody looking in by way of the internet, this will be the year. Maybe this will be the year for you to make some decisions for the Lord. That no matter what, no matter what it costs, you're going to do these things for the Lord. It's a year of decision. It's a new year. God's given us a new year. What are we going to do with it? Are we going to have greater faith? Are we going to be found lacking? What are we going to do? You decide today what this year will bring. How will it be a year of crossing over? Let's pray together. I ask you to bow your heads, close your eyes. No one looking around. We do that to be serious with God, and we also do that to allow everyone the individual and private privilege of dealing with God on their own. I don't know what God might be speaking to you about. He may have been speaking to you for a long, long time. And this morning, just this simple message about crossing over, you've said in your heart, well, I will make 2014 the year that I do this, do that. Maybe 2014 will be the year that you cry out to Jesus Christ for salvation, that you admit your sin, that all those things that God's Word says you ought not to do, that you've done, that you'd ask God to forgive you for them and tell God you're sorry for them, and that you'd trust what Jesus Christ did when He died on the cross and shed His blood and was buried and rose again the third day, that and that alone would be your salvation. Not that you're a good person, not that you've done good things, for they can never, ever outweigh even one sin. The Word of God says all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. Just throw them away. But you could ask Jesus Christ to be your Savior today. Jesus, be merciful to me, a sinner. Maybe this year be the year that you step out by faith, say, God, I'm trusting you. I'm tired of being all worried and worked up and all. I'm just going to trust you that you'd do the things you've promised in your Word to do. I'm going to hang on to some of those promises, like, my God shall supply all our need in Christ Jesus. I'm going to hang on to the fact that the Word of God says God's children never go begging. I'm going to hang on to that. I'm going to hang on to the Word of God that says that if I give out the Word, it will not return void, but it'll do what it's promised to do. How are you going to cross over 2014? Father, I come to you and I praise you and I thank you again for your love and grace and all the blessings that are ours, and thank you for another year. And Lord God, I have no idea. This year might be the year that this church fills because a lot of souls are saved.
all the sowing of seed for years and years and years that we've done will start to bring forth fruit. Some 100-fold and some 60 and 40 and 20-fold. Lord, we could see some great things. Lord, maybe this is the year that we get our own building. This is nice, Lord. This is nice, but I don't want this to become, you know, another rut, another place where we stagnate. But this might just be a jumping off place, a place where we can grow some and then have that vision and see some things happen. Lord, may this year be a year that we grow in Christ, that we become more like Him. Do some great things, if you would. Help us, for we need you. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd ask you to stand with me. We're going to sing hymn number 15, The Way of the Cross Leads Home. And we're going to sing it because it talks about a new place for us. And hymn number 15, The Way of the Cross Leads Home. If God's spoken to you about something this morning and you need to take care of it, either kneel down where you are or come here. We'll show you from the Word of God how you can be saved, whatever it might be. If God wants you to do something, do it this morning, if you would. You're not obligated to sing. You're obligated to do what the Holy Spirit tells you to do. Amen. The Way of the Cross Leads Home. Let's sing it. Instead of lively, let's sing it a little bit more solemn, now that it might help us to focus on what God wants. I must needs go home by the way of the cross. There's no other way but this. I shall ne'er get sight of the gates of light if the way of the cross I miss. The way of the cross leads home. The way of the cross leads home. It is sweet to know as I onward go. The way of the cross leads home. I must needs go on in the blood-sprinkled way, the path that the Savior trod. If I ever climb to the heights sublime where the soul is at home with God, the way of the cross leads home. The way of the cross leads home. It is sweet to know as I onward go, the way of the cross leads home. Then I bid farewell to the way of the world, to walk in it nevermore. For my Lord says, come, and I seek my home, where He waits at the open door. The way of the cross leads home. The way of the cross leads home. It is sweet to know as I onward go. The way of the cross leads home. See that crossing over in verse 3, that stanza 3, then I bid farewell to the way of the world, to walk in it nevermore. For my Lord says, come, and I seek my home. I cross over and go in. Blaine, would you close us in a word of prayer, please?
Yes, let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we do love you, and we thank you for the love that you have for us. We thank you for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, died on the cross. And we thank you, Father, that we did cross over, that we accepted Christ as our Savior. that he called for us. Lord, we pray for those that heard this message today, that you would speak through that message to people's hearts, Lord, and that should someone be unsaved, that they would accept Christ as their Savior. Lord, we pray that you would be with us today as we go home and as we return this afternoon. Keep us safe, Lord. We ask that you would, as we look forward to hearing your message this afternoon. Father, we pray this now in Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 Lord bless you, dear ones.